what a UAV is, was heard of one.
When you say drone, I know.
Yes, yes. So UAV is commonly referred to as drones. I will refrain from using that term today because it has conflicting definitions and viewpoints and usually a negative connotation. But professionally and technically, they refer to as UAVs. So small unmanned aerial vehicles is what they stand for. Focus on small, because UAVs can be a MQ Reaper that the military uses or a drone that fits in your pocket. So it has a very large spectrum of kind of what defines what a drone actually is or UAV. And they have lots of different purposes. So not only are they used for delivery photography, surveying, military assessment, they mostly come in two categories, and that's civilian military purposes. Today I'll be focusing primarily on the humanitarian aspect of UAVs, as that pertains to the civil side of UAV usage. And then just by definition, the propulsion system for a UAV would be whatever means of keeping it afloat in the sky. So yeah, so a couple more applications. So I'll be focusing on the top three right now, which is search and rescue delivery and disaster relief. That comprises of the humanitarian relief aspect of UAV usage. But also use surveying, filmmaking, marketing, commercial, private, agriculture, and lots more. I'm a freshman drone pilot, and I have a drone company's license. It's like, man, I primarily focus on the filmmaking, marketing, commercial aspect of that, but there's a lot more applications that drones can be used for on a day-to-day basis, and it's growing more and more. It's really exciting. So we're going to get into exactly what a hydrogen fuel cell is shortly, but I'm going to start off with another question. How many of you guys have been impacted by a natural disaster event in the last couple of years? Maybe a hurricane or tornado or flooding? Yeah, yeah, so more and more so. I've had several friends that, so I'm North Carolina State University. I'm a sophomore studying aerospace engineering. And I've had a lot of friends on the coast who they've been flooded and devastated and their house destroyed by hurricanes because outer banks just kind of stick out there. And so, and that's just going to be more and more the case with climate change. And that's sad, but we can do something about that. Right now, the response time is very long, especially if you guys have you guys heard of the Ocracoke Island? It's only accessible via boat, and so it takes usually about 2 hours to get there, the quickest way. But by drone, you can get there within about 15 minutes. So we can severely cut down that time. So Hurricane Dorian left a calamitous footprint damage in the area, about $1.53 billion in total damage. And it's mostly cost borne by restoration from catastrophic events. But the UAVs were able to help with disaster relief to help save money and time. And so I looked into exactly how can UAVs be used to enhance humanitarian aid operations, and more specifically, the flight endurance aspect. So most drones, I guess what I've seen, pretty common, go back here, you see like the basic quadcopters over here, I'm sure you guys have seen some of those. There's usually about a plateau of about 15 to 30 minutes of total flight time in a given drone. That's probably usually given to the fact that there are lithium-ion, lithium polymer batteries, and so they have that plateau of flight time. And that's great. However, it's not great when you're trying to use it for a long period of time, such as for search and rescue or humanitarian aid purposes, or if you're trying to deliver blood samples from one location that's 50 miles away, and you just can't get there on a single battery. So that there's a gap there, but how can we extend flight time to enhance those missions? How we can look into serving others in a way and grow the capacity there. So I brought tiny drones with me here today. So can't fly much larger than the plane, but this is a tiny drone. For example, this one can fly for about a half an hour. It has a simple lithium-ion battery in the back of it here. But the chemical composite here can't allow for it to fly much more than that, so it plateaus at that time. So if I want to use this drone for a specific humanitarian aid purpose, let's say I want to fly probably I wouldn't be able to do that because it would run out of battery. So the way I looked into it, I was exploring propulsion methods on how to, what are other unconventional methods and how we can, again, keep a drone in the air for longer. And then I came across different, there are two variables in drones, and primarily you have your unimotor UAVs, so helicopters. You got multimotor UAVs, such as quadcopters, and you've got fixed-wing UAVs, such as planes, more or less. And so, doing a cross-sectional study here, we looked into, there's a company called Zipline out in Rwanda, and also they operate in Ghana and Namibia, where they have, they transport blood transfusion samples long distances with similar style drones to the one on top left there. The way they do it is a fixed wing drone, has two propellers, and they drop down the payload in advance in parachute, and it can cut down time for blood transfusion from 6 to 7 hours in some locations, taking back roads to only half an hour. So looking at that, how can we make that more fuel efficient? How can we extend that? So I reached out to the Naval Research Laboratory, DC. They've had some experience with a lot of hydrogen fuel cell research. So that's what gets us back to fuel cells. I was looking into a total of three or four different propulsion methods, including solar, lithium polymer, lithium-ion, and fuel cells. It turns out that fuel cells offer a pretty enticing propulsion method due to their low mass and high efficiency output. And so pretty much what a fuel cell is it takes in hydrogen as gas form and it converts that to fuel along with oxygen. And the only output would be water. So it's very clean, very renewable, and great thing is we have lots of hydrogen and stuff. So I thought that would be a pretty convincing method of doing that. This research found out that there are a couple companies now, such as Quaternium, that are using hydrogen fuel cells and manned aircraft as well as vehicles and cars. So more and more, that's kind of cutting edge in terms of all-wheel drive and kind of drivetrain motors would be fuel cells. They offer very high output of power and efficiency for that. So here's an example of a couple of fuel cells here. So this is a pretty small one. It's about the size of a football or so. This is a fuel cell tank where you store the hydrogen on the aircraft itself. It's got a carbon composite on the outside to help with the load bearing of the fuel as well. So doing more research in this, I was like, how can we apply this to multi-rotor UAV since it's already being applied to fixed-wing UAV? And so I went to the Naval Research Laboratory, did some research with my ex-supervisor, Karen Smartlines, and we looked into the research, and they have a fixed-wing UAV called Spiderline, and it contains a powerful fuel cell. Iron Tiger is a fixed-wing, similar fuel cell. It became a huge success after sustaining a 48-hour-long flight containing a 5-pound payload back in 2013. And this 550-watt fuel cell offered a new humidifier design, a high-power stack, integrated control electronics, and water cooled regulated high-power commercial fuel cell membranes, such as this one right here. And so using this, looking at this more, how can we apply that to a multi-rotor UAV? As a main drawback, a fixed-wing UAV can hover. It's a continuous flight, and it's usually watched by accelerated watcher systems, such as like a slingshot to get airborne. However, if we can fix it, that same technology on a fixed wing, on a multi-rotor UAV, then we'd be able to do routine inspections in other missions such as search and rescue in hard reach areas. Because right now, for example, in the mountains of North Carolina, they do search and rescue as well as in the Rockies with drones, but they can only fly for about 20 minutes due to the heat dissipation and the cold during avalanches and during the winter time. However, if we can adapt a way to fix a hydrogen fuel cell to that, we could keep a drone airborne for hours and hours and save more. crashing, like, you know, maybe your best friend Joe, maybe took a bad fall on the slopes and he got lost in an avalanche. You don't know where he is. And search teams might be out there for days with the given technology, but that can be cut down to just a few hours with a prolonged flight time of a multi-party UAV. So, looking into this more, the importance of this has a lot of outputs, not only just in humanitarian aid, but also just delivery in general for consumer products. You could do long distance delivery, transmission, as well as just increased aid in general. So I hope this research could be translated toward that, to promote general welfare, than just what it's used for, and staying away from the main kind of military use right now of destroying human lives rather than saving them. So looking into this more, I decided to use a blind fuel method. I used a true experimental quantitative research method here, where I analyzed the existing capabilities of lithium-ion, lithium polymer fuel drones, along with that of a fixed-wing hydrogen fuel cell drone. At this time, I didn't have the resources to affix a hydrogen fuel cell to a multi-rotor UAV. I hope to do that by the end of my undergraduate every year and explore this research more. But doing the meta cross research meta-analysis between the current drones, such as this one here, and hydrogen fuel cell drones that are fixed wing, and seeing how we can translate that technology to that. So given this, multi-rotors result in lots of difficulties in innovation, such as their size, their weight, payload, hovering capabilities, et cetera, et cetera. And so adapting a fuel cell that is meant for a fixed wing drone or UAV, putting it on a multi-rotor UAV has a lot of complications. And so navigating those would be a little bit challenging. But however, we see in this graph over here, the power output through the duration for fuel cells is much greater than that of the primary batteries. And so using that information, my hypothesis was that fuel cells would be the way to go for multi-rotor UAV for distance flight, becoming more efficient. So here's another display seeing kind of the variable weight and range of a lithium-ion battery versus fuel cell. So the range is much greater for a fuel cell to a weight ratio versus a lithium-ion. That's quite longer and linear for that ratio there. So using that again, methodology would be combining a true experimental research method with the given resources with lithium-ion polymer batteries and cross doing a meta-analysis of that with fixed-wing hydrogen fuel cell UAVs. You could do a translational analysis and see how that could actually be applicable for that. So first, I conducted the flight tests for lithium polymer UAVs. Then I collected that data and then I analyzed that using a t-test variable statistical analysis between that and a fixed-wing hydrogen fuel cell, and then so when I did my flight test for UAVs, I simulated a search and rescue operation where I orbited around this park and pretty much just continued the operational mission until ran out of battery. And so as you can see here, this is the flight path of the Mavic 2 Zoom that I used for the experimental research purposes. And it was able to make, you know, five laps around the subject, say, until it was no longer able to fly. And so using that, I was able to record power output, current, flight time, and other important variables, and I could cross that with the existing data from a fixed-wing hydrogen fuel cell, such as the Lion Tiger. So all of this is not complete accuracy of the humanitarian aid mission that I completed, and was able to gather some pretty useful data from that. So on the left here, these are the UAVs that we used for that mission. You can see it in the field here for now. On the right side, you can see the Iron Tiger fuel cell UAV that I compared it to over here. So this is the fixed wing UAV. see that power versus time, and same from the hydrogen fuel cell UAV. Power, as you can see, was relatively the same for both. There is a large spike in the middle during a windstorm in which the UAV functioned at a higher power output ratio. But as you can see, the flight time was different longer for the fixed wing UAV versus the Inspire. So I used some of the, I used MATLAB data code and compiled some of the t-test calculation of the variables here, comparing the voltage and battery temperature and current between the two. And this is some of the data we got here. So the easiest way to compare the two would be to compare efficiency, which is across the ratio of power to mass. So obviously, Iron Tiger, if we go back here, is significantly larger than one of these internal UAVs. And that's the one main drawback of using fuel cells is the size of it. So looking into maybe in the future, seeing if we can minimize the size and impact and the footprint of fuel cells, so we can fix it to smaller UAVs, it would be greatly beneficial. So you can see here, the power output for Mach 2 is significantly less than the Inspire. Inspire and the Iron Tiger are quite comparable. Mass was significantly more for the Iron Tiger, as I said earlier. But using that efficiency, the lower the number here for the efficiency, the greater. So as you can see, the fuel cell UAV was significantly more efficient than the Inspire and the Mach 2. And so using that, kind of making drawing cross meta-analysis there, that using that proportion method would be a great viable option in the future to accept to be multi-rotor UAV. So a couple of limitations in my research here. This was conducted during COVID-19. So this feature was a part of the Indian Research Program, the Captain Program. And a part of that was when you're actually conducting your research was in March of 2020. And you might have heard of a pandemic occurring during that time. Which very greatly limited my options on how to achieve data. Thankfully, about 2 to 4 things shut down. I was able to go to DC to get some of the data from the research laboratory, as well as partnering with NASA lately and doing research at NC State. And kind of using that, I did the flight analysis with the multi-rotor UAVs during the pandemic, and was able to use that and cross that. So crossing that, as well as restriction of limited resources, just feasibility during that time, there are several limitations that prevented me from achieving my actual goal of what I would like to do with seeing if we could actually use the propulsion method for fixed-wing UAVs on multi-rotor UAVs. As you can see now, that's largely applicable. And if we can do that and obtain more resources in the future, I think that would be greatly beneficial. So in conclusion here, if we're able to, there are a couple of companies who have tried to use hydrogen fuel cells on multi-rotor UAVs and been unsuccessful right now. But there are there's one company out of California that's actually using hydrogen fuel cells on a small manned aircraft and have gotten some promising results, but not the range that they're looking for. But if we can look into minimizing the footprint of a fuel cell and adapting that to a multi-rotor UAV, that could greatly benefit the future of flight for drones themselves and applications. But not only that, it can also benefit humanitarian emissions in that of delivering hematology samples, blood samples, transfusions, as well as social rescue missions and